dental crowding, I have all of that, early onset arthritis, I got these beauties at age 40. I was horrified. I'm like, I'm not supposed to have this at 40, I'm supposed to have this at 80. 40. Chronic debilitating pain. Infants tend to experience poor muscle tone and they don't reach their developmental milestones. I apparently did not have this, but I told you, you know, it's no two EDS patients are the same. That is very, very common with hypermobility. The vascular type is the really scary type that has quite a truncated life expectancy. I think it's age 48. That's when the cardiovascular system is so badly impacted that you have things like a ruptured aorta or a ruptured intestine or heart or uterus. So when I was diagnosed by the geneticist, she had a first year med student in the room with her and she said to him, pay attention. I don't know how accurate this is, but this is what she said. The 6 hours that you get during your medical training on Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, you'll hear about the stretchy skin and the rupturing heart. You won't hear about hypermobility, so pay attention. Apparently, can anyone corroborate or deny that? How that's trained, anyone? No? But those are the two apparently most people know about, classical and vascular. I can't even pronounce the next three. 1, 2, 3, 4. Kyphoscoliosis, that affects the spine and it's a curvature to one side more than the other. It also has a bunch of other symptoms, severe progressive curvature of the spine, potential life-threatening complications. I don't know what this is. Tarlov cysts, anyone? No? Well, if you haven't heard of them, I certainly haven't. Organ rupture, blood vessels that tear, arteries that dissect, and so forth. This one I really can't pronounce. It's quite rare that when infants are born with bilateral hip dysplasia, both hips are displaced. And then dermatopraxis, I practiced that. Very rare, thank heavens. It's all about the skin, but it's different. It results in redundant folds of skin that don't belong, and it gets worse with age. I saw a picture of a woman with this once, and there was just folds of skin hanging everywhere. Really awful. But it's very rare, 10 cases worldwide, which is not much. 10 cases too many, but not much. Classic and hypermobility apparently have the same kind of prevalence in the population. I don't know about classic, but I really think hypermobile is not that rare. I think that it is much more underdiagnosed than it is. That's my opinion. It's not only my opinion, in all the reading that I've done, a lot of people think that too. Just for completion's sake, there are three more types. I can't pronounce them. The one has to do with the mouth. the progeroid. What's that disease called where those little kids look like old
people?
What's it called?
Progeria.
Progeria. It's similar. It has a similar kind of appearance. It's a connective tissue disorder, but it results in the same kind of appearance. And then cardiac valvular is specifically to do with the cardiac, just with the valves of the heart, nothing else. Each type has very specific diagnostic criteria. And every type except for hypermobility has a specific gene associated with it. They have not yet isolated the gene for the hypermobile type, which is part of our problem as patients. If you have the vascular type or the classic type, you can get it confirmed with a genetic test. With hypermobility, you can't. So let's deal with the, I mentioned this. So each of these types has specific criteria for diagnosis. They include characteristics, some of which I've already talked to you about, clinical observation by a geneticist, and then genetic testing if the type of EDS that you're testing has that. Hypermobile type is the most difficult to diagnose, and primarily because there's a lack of confirmatory or molecular tests. But it's my type. This is my type of EDS. I'm just putting that up there because the name has changed over the years. It started out as EDS3, and in fact, when the rheumatologist initially diagnosed me, he said, I think you have EDS3. I said, I've got who? Never heard of it. Then it went on to be called Ehlers-Danlos syndrome hypermobility type, which is a mouthful, and now it's just heads spelled like that, hypermobility type, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. The diagnostic criteria have very recently been tightened up this year, in fact, in 2017. I nearly said 2017. They're trying to isolate the gene associated with it, and unless they have a homogenous group, they can't do that. What has happened with hypermobility type Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, it kind of became an umbrella for everybody who had hypermobile joints. And that's not actually so. So now the Ehlers-Danlos Society has separated out joint hypermobility spectrum disorders and Ehlers-Danlos hypermobility spectrum so that they can arrive at a more homogenous group and start to work towards isolating the gene. In fact, they've started, I got an invitation to be part of a study that is going on in Boston. I can't remember which hospital it is. I wrote to them and I said, but I haven't heard from them. So they're starting to do that. They're starting to work with a more homogenous group to try and actually isolate the gene, and that'll be wonderful if we can get there. I've mentioned that many times already, but I feel quite strongly about it. And it seems so benign because your heart's not going to rupture or your aorta's not going to rupture and you can't pull your skin out 3 feet. It's not benign. It has a very high disability quotient, I guess. So how's it been for me? I didn't start out with sore joints. I started out with hypermobile joints. And I started out with very bad headaches and very bad stomach aches. A problematic menstrual cycle, very heavy periods and anemia and everything that goes along with that. When I got to age 40, this started happening with my fingers, which was a surprise. But my joints didn't really... I was exercise averse, but my joints didn't really hurt me badly until, I guess, about age 50. And then my SI joints started to hurt like hell, and then my hips, and then my knees, and now this joint at the base of that, and it's starting to hurt in my neck, and it's progressed quite quickly, alarmingly. I imagine I'm 58. My joints have 58 years of wear and tear on them, and they're not normal. So anyone else here who's 58, who has 58-year-old joints, knows what I'm talking about. Just add a connective tissue disorder on top of that, and you'll get some indication of how it works. So I really hope that I don't get there. I'm terrified of getting there. I've started going to aqua therapy to try and strengthen the joints, particularly around my knees and my hips. And I've started walking with my sticks. And actually build some muscles.
Would you ever be a candidate for joint replacement? Is that something that's feasible?
I don't know. And I've asked this question there's no EDS specialist to go and ask this question of. And if you ask an orthopedic surgeon, he doesn't know. I asked the question of my Facebook support group, and nobody in there had done it. So I'm left to thinking it through myself. And I've concluded that it probably wouldn't help because all the tendons and ligaments are made from compromised connective tissue. So if I have the joint replaced, what's going to hold it? I don't know.
Is there anything to slow the progression down?
The problem is it's either the actual protein in the collagen or it's something that mediates it, but it's not, it doesn't, it's faulty. My collagen is faulty. So there are all sorts of alternate things that I've sort of looked into. One of them, I think, is called Rolo therapy. Not any bells?
Can you spell it?
Sorry?
Can you spell it?
Well, I'm not sure that I can even pronounce it. I think it's R-O-L-O. I might be wrong. That's a therapy that they use in joints where they actually deliberately cause little micro tears in the joint in order to build up scar tissue, so that the scar tissue can work as some kind of scaffolding. But when I thought that through, I thought, well, that's great. My scar tissue is also going to be made of crappy connective tissue, so I don't really see how that can possibly help. So I don't know. My genes need to be fixed. which is why I said up front, we need funding, because we need research, because eventually we need to find a cure for this damn thing, because it's debilitating. Maybe. Who knows? Hopefully. A bit late for me, but maybe one day in the future.